Hey guys, this is another Tech Nitwit production videos, and I'm going to bring you the Ubiquiti Unified Biosphere of devices. I have right here is the USG, and we are going to do the setup and install video. I'm in the future right now. I got it all in my rack, but I'm going to take you guys back to the future, and we are going to show you how to install this wonderful equipment. So I'll take you right back. All right, guys, we are going to get the USG hooked up. I got internet coming up over here. And I'm gonna come up over here and pretty much plug the internet into here. So I got one cable that goes to my PC, one cable that comes from my modem. My modem's gonna come over here, go into the WAN, and my PC's gonna come over here and go into the LAN. And we are just gonna get this guy set up and provisioned, and then we will go and get all the rest of the equipment set up. So I'm gonna let that guy recognize the network, come over here and let's see if we have internet. We do. So come over here and let's check our adapter settings. And make sure that we have the right make sure we have the right IP address. Hit details. And we do. So let's just check Yahoo really quick. Or Google. Google's working. It's just grab a random page, that's working. Okay, so we got the USG hooked up. That's the first thing we wanted to do. Now I'm gonna pipe the USG over to the switch and plug my computer into our 48 port. So I'm gonna come back around here, guys, plug everything in, make sure this is all plugged in. I'm gonna come and grab my PC cable and I'm gonna go and put that in. Let's just go in number 2. The XG is booting right now. I'm gonna grab my DAC cable, my short DAC cable, and this is gonna go into the SFP1 on the 48 port. And we are gonna come over here. We're gonna go to port, doesn't really matter on the XG, but I just put it in port 11 because it's closest to this side. We're gonna grab our yellow cable right here, and this is gonna be from our WAN.
Doesn't matter what port you put it in as long as it's one of the ports on the switch, guys. I'm putting it in port 47 here, but you can put it in anyone.
Between the XG and the USG, or the XG and my 48 port switch. So I'm going to come here and plug the USG into 48. Just best practices. And that is pretty much everything set up. We do have to plug in the cloud key. So I'm going to come here and port cloud key in port number 1. You can put it in which port you like. It doesn't really matter for this guy, as long as it's a PoE port. If it's not, if you do not have PoE set up, you're going to want to go ahead and plug in the USB-C adapter and power this guy up. And I'm going to go ahead and start plugging in my APs. So you can put them into wherever you like. I'm just going to do it so you guys can see the lights and it looks kind of cool. I love networking lights. I think they look awesome. So I'm just going to spread them out here. But in hindsight, you could just have them all together really close to each other. We're going to see all our APs come up. They're white, so they're getting power. You know, they're getting PoE plus. And see all our APs are powered up. And I like setting this stuff up on the desk like this because it lets me know that everything is up and running. It's working. We're not having any issues. But that's pretty much how you connect everything if you were to put it on the table. So the first thing I'm going to come over here is I am going to open up Chrome or any web browser, Firefox, whatever your favorite flavor is. Type in 192.168.1.1. Going to go ahead and hit enter. It's going to say it's not secured. Don't worry, it's okay. That is fine. And it's going to bring our management software back up, which is perfectly fine. We just gotta find our, key. If some reason the client name isn't popping up, what you can do is look at the bottom of the key right here and look at the Mac and look for the Mac ID. And my ID is gonna end with 44F3. There's a sticker right here. I don't know if you guys can see this right here. So if it doesn't come up, I got it upside down right now. I'll put a picture up over here of what it looks like, guys. So it's gonna have a bunch of numbers, then a space, and then your MAC address, and then a space. So I see 44F3. I'm gonna come over here and look for 44F3. and 44F3 right here. I don't know if you guys can see that. And it's going to be 12. So I'm going to come and grab this IP. I'm going to right click and I'm going to go to. It's going to bring another non-secure page up. We're going to hit advanced. We're going to do proceed to 192.168.1.12. And of course, it's going to bring the cloud key management page up. We're going to go to this top guy and we're going to hit manage. Now, in here, there is going to be a setting that you're going to have to click to agree to their terms of service, which is right here. And then if you want to name your network, this is where you would name your, you know, your network and stuff like that. So I'm just going to leave the, or name your controller, I'm sorry, name your controller. So I'm going to do TechNetWits controller or whatever you can put there. I'm just going to do dash controller because it doesn't have controller in there. Don't mind me if I don't spell it correctly. So now it says Unified Network Controller, next. And this is if you had a Ubiquiti Unified account, you're going to put your information in right here. I will put a link up down here to where you can go and sign up for an account. And then you enter it in here. And this will allow you to do remote management, meaning from Ubiquiti's website, you can pull up a remote management page and actually get into your switch. So if you have a business or an offsite backup center, or say you got a second factory, or say you got two businesses and they're all running Ubiquiti Unified, say somebody starts is having problems at their second site, you can actually remotely log into this web page and get into it. And that's what the remote access stuff does. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to blank this stuff out, but you're going to put your own stuff here. There is a second way you can actually set this guy up, and that would be go to switch to advanced and unclick the remote manage. And click those two off, and then you're going to create a local account. Going to go ahead and hit next, and it's going to say automatically optimize my network. You can leave this on. I turn it off personally. It pretty much is. It automatically detects and sets the most commonly missed but vital settings for improved Wi-Fi and network performance. If you know what you're doing, you can turn this off. If you do not know what you're doing, leave it on. Enable auto backup. I will say this right now, enable that auto backup. Let it do the automatic backups. I would say back it up. It makes life a lot easier if stuff gets messed up somehow, or if you're just learning networking. It's gonna help you out a lot to back this stuff up. So go ahead and hit next. It's gonna list all the devices that it sees. So we're gonna double check to make sure all our devices are seen. I see 1, 2, 3 APs, I see our 16 gig, I see our 48 port, and I see our USG. We're in our cloud key right now, so it doesn't need to be listed. So I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 devices. 6 devices are listed on the page. Of course, if you're accessing the cloud key, it's there. So it's not gonna be listed. Go ahead and hit next, guys. And this is where you're gonna name your Wi-Fi, network. So I'm just gonna do TechNetWits Wi-Fi, or I'll just do TechNetWit. And then I'm gonna do a password. You gotta be careful when you're setting up your Wi-Fi. Most Wi-Fi passwords are required to be 8 characters, have at least a letter and a number. I would say just for security purposes, do a uppercase letter, do a regular letter, and then at least 8 numbers. So a 10 character password, just for sanity. Or make it a sentence. I really like sentences. Say you really like Tang soft drinks, just say, you can do I space really like Tang soft drink, and then do a pin at the end. Do like maybe not your bank pin, but come up with like a pin for an old telephone number that you remember. So, and you have it memorized. Go ahead and enter that last 4 in there and use that as a pin. That'll make it very secure. So I'm gonna just do I love tech knit wit 6688. And that's now my Wi-Fi password. I would say that that's pretty secure. Go ahead and hit next. And it's gonna go over all your information and it's gonna ask you your country or territory. It should auto-populate, but if it does not, there's a little error here that you can go and change it. I'm -6, so I'm Chicago, so I'm gonna hit finish. And this usually takes, I would say anywhere between 3 and 5 minutes is what this would take. I already have all my stuff updated, so this should go pretty fast. Sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it doesn't. So expect to spend about 3 to 5 minutes here. So I'm gonna go through some of the more advanced settings once this is done. I will also go and show you how to create a secondary Wi-Fi network. You don't wanna combine your Wi-Fi network. I don't know if I went over that setting, I might've missed it. Don't combine your Wi-Fi, your 2.4 and your 5 gigahertz, because if you got legacy devices or devices that only use 2.4, you don't want it to have it combined. Some of them can have issues. The newer devices don't have so much of a problem, but some of the older devices really have an issue when you try to combine that network. So the first thing that's gonna pop up is gonna be this security and analytic tab. I don't send because I like my privacy. I don't want Ubiquiti knowing my network usage. I don't want them knowing how I use my network, when I use my network. If you want to help them out and do beta programs and stuff like that, go ahead and do send to Ubiquiti, and then you send all your unified data to Ubiquiti. I personally don't send. So as you can see, we have nothing populated in here. This is because we still have to adopt all our unified devices. How we're going to do that is I'm going to come here and go and click on the device guy, and I'm going to see all my devices. And you can go over here and just right click and hit adopt right here. But I like to do it a little bit different. I'll left click on all these guys and I will left click each one and it'll populate it up on this side. And then I hit adopt and then X, click on my next AP, hit adopt, then X, clicked on my next AP, hit adopt, then X, then on my 48 port switch, hit adopt, then X. Go ahead and hit the 16XG, hit adopt, then X, and then my USG, my security gateway, gonna hit adopt. Gonna come back here, and I like the different larger view where it shows the icons across the screen. So you're gonna come up here in this right-hand corner and you can click here, and it'll actually show them as a larger picture. We're gonna wait for these green lines of provisioning to be done. It's gonna take anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes for your devices to provision. You're gonna see how the lights are starting to change here. They're going to solid blue. Look at like this AP, it's solid blue. If you look at our USG, it's a really cool blue. Come over here, see that, it's solid blue. And our guy right here is solid blue. So everything is pretty much adopting right now, and we will let it do its thing. As you can see, our stuff is adopted. So we got 2 switches, 3 access points. We got our internet capacity and our USG. Now, something I need to make you guys aware of, I did go over when I explained the USG, is a setting that is called ISD and IPS. And you got to be really careful what's said in these settings. It's security and it will keep your stuff safe. But if you per se, like I have 500 down by 25, the regular USG will not support that. I will have a diagram up here or down here of all the different speeds the different security gateways can handle. That's if you come in here and you go down here and you're to go to threat management and enable this right here, this is going to actually kill your throughput. So if you've enabled this and you're wondering, hey, why am I only getting 85 megs per second when I have 500 megs per second down on my internet? That is why. One quick thing that I do is I like to enable the advanced settings or more settings. And I gotta find it really quick. So right here, you go to user interface and you do new settings and it changes all this. And I personally don't like the dark settings. Some people do, so I unclick that. And then I go ahead and hit apply. And for some reason, it's still using the dark settings, but I don't know why it's glitching out, but I guess we'll move on from here. So if you wanna create another network, so we created the TechNitWit network. And if we come here and we look, we got default, then TechNitWit. So that's gonna be my split network. That's gonna be where I put all my slow devices. I wanna create a fast network. We wanna be on Wi-Fi networks. Create new network, and you can do basic. If you don't understand it in here, you just do the basic settings. There are gonna be some settings that I wanna touch on for the faster network, so I'm gonna do create advanced Wi-Fi network. Of course, I'm gonna name this TechNitWit-6000. And then enable this network correct. Our security is gonna be WPA personal. You could do enterprise, but you have to look at the radius settings. This is past the purview of this. I might do another video if you guys want me to do explaining radius. There are some comments down below and I'll do a video on it if this gets enough views and likes. So you're gonna come down here and you're gonna see network access. I wanna come down here and I wanna do enable fast roaming. I wanna do combined name SSI and SSID. So that combines these two. They do have optimized for higher end devices for 5 gigahertz. I will look into that and I'll probably throw that down below how to do that. Pretty much that's it. You can also enable 2G data rate control. Once the network's created, you can actually go in there and you can make it so that that network only does the faster speeds. And with the mesh, it should kick you over to this networking or kick you off if you're doing slower speeds and stuff like that. That's past the purview of this video. I'm not going to get into those settings right now. If you would like me to, throw another comment down below and I will. Pretty much I'm going to go ahead and hit done. And that's going to create my second Wi-Fi network. I'm just going to go over some more of the general settings, guys, and then we'll finish up this video. And there we go. We got TechNitWit 6000. Wi-Fi AI. This is a really cool feature. You can have it actually scan your network. So say if you got an AP set up on your north and your south side of your house, say your neighbor is blasting channels 3, 4, and 5, and them channels are bad. This will scan and put that AP on 7, 8, and 9, or 2, 3, and 1. The other thing is you can enable this. I enable this. You can also do exclusions and all sorts of crazy stuff and scan time and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm gonna come down here and let's talk about the network settings quick. And this is where you would go if you wanted to change your IP address for your gateway and all that other stuff, your size of your actual client size. So if you're running /24, you can come in here and actually do your submasks in different sizes. That's where you would go for this. If you're running DHCP or not, with the USG, you're probably gonna be running DHCP client. If you're running PFSINs, you're probably gonna be having it clicked on none. Going to be looking at these network settings. So here's your DHCP server. If you got a DHCP relay, that's going to be more on the advanced side. This is where the settings going to be. You got a hotspot creator. I have not even touched this. So I honestly haven't even looked into the settings. But if you'd like me to get into them and research them and make a video, you know what to do. I've already said it like twice. I don't want to overdo it. So the other setting you're going to come down here is internet security. This is the throughput stuff I was talking about. It actually warns you right here. It says enable threat management will affect Unified Security Gateway 3P maximum throughput, 85 megabytes per second. So you got intrusion detection and intrusion prevention. If you're going to run this, do the intrusion prevention system. If you're going to use it, you might as well use it all the way. Of course, you got different stuff you can select here. Sometimes there are false positives with this stuff, so just be aware, because I run an IDS and IPS with PFSINs and I get false positives all the time. I have to go in there and whitelist them. So moving on, you do have GOIP filtering, and that is to allow you to block IP lists. So per se, you don't want your networking gear talking to Russia. Like, there's no websites that you go that are in Russia. You can block the whole subnets from Russia. If you don't talk to Australia, and then go in there and say you do start using a website that's in Russia, you can whitelist it. But this'll, if you got Chinese websites talking to you and you're not using Chinese websites, there should be no reason a server from China should be trying to talk to your gear. Deep packet inspection is gonna actually look at packets and try to determine if they're a threat or not. You got all sorts of different type of rules you can create in here. I'm not gonna get into it too deep. And then of course, firewall rules. Firewall rules are gonna pretty much be like what you see right here. You got accept and drop rules. So port 302 is drop. Anything that's gonna try to communicate on an IP address, that port through your gear, it's gonna drop it. Of course, and then you have accept rules. Say you want stuff on port 301 on every IP to accept it, you're gonna make sure it has accept in all protocols and then WAN in. So you got VPN, which is a very private network. The VPN is gonna make it like you're actually on the local network. So the next one is gonna be your gateway. The USG talks to your gateway is pretty much the USG. It talks to your modem, and then you can set all your settings in here. You got static routes, DHCP, dynamic DNS. Dynamic DNS is
your IP changes with your service provider, this is gonna keep that updated, and that will allow you to pretty much run a website or a domain and have it communicate with your gear and not have to worry about paying for a static IP IP address from a service provider. You got SNMP, which is a simple network management protocol. UPnP, don't use it. UPnP has so many security flaws and issues. It's a good way to make your network very vulnerable. So a lot of people like to use it because it simplifies stuff. But if you can't learn how to port forward and use firewall rules and, you know, port forwarding and stuff like that, really spend the time and go research it for a couple hours. For LEDs, or if they got some of the unifies that have the actual screens on there, this is where all the settings for that will be. You got user interface settings, so the look and feel. You know, I want to make sure I'm on that, on the non-dark one. So let's do this. Let's apply that and see if we can get it on the light colored one. Yeah, it doesn't want to let me. That's pretty much all the settings, guys. You got alert settings, so I can actually put my email address in here, and if an AP falls off, I think it'll actually send you email alerts. And of course you have the settings, and you're gonna enter in all the SMTP information and your email information. Of course, a lot of the stuff you don't have to set up if you set up the remote management stuff and fill out the Ubiquiti Unified account. But if you end up using a local account, this will still allow you to get all the email stuff. You can manually go into here and set that up. You got admins, which is just if I wanted to create a second, you know, administrator. So say you got the owner of a company, he's very technical, and then you got, you know, he's more like the CEO, and then you got your IT guy. Well, you could have two users in here with different levels of accounting. You can go in here and pretty much do, you know, add a new, you know, user, and it walks you right through it. The nice thing about the Unify hardware, their Biosphere, is the Unify stuff really simplifies networking. It makes it really easy, and the everyday Joe can just figure it out and get it done. Of course, you got updates, and you can actually come in here and see your different devices and where and what they've been updated to, and that's kind of neat. And you can catch the updates if you want. So say you got 100 of these on your network, you can catch it, and that will allow it to act kind of like a proxy where we'll grab that update, and you won't have to download it for each individual device. Say you have a large campus that has like 100, you know, 48 port 500 watt switches, you're not gonna want that update downloading for every switch, so you could come in here and catch it. That's what this does. And then you got advanced, which is just more advanced stuff for updating. This was Tech Nitwit, and I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Tech Nitwit out, guys.
Hey guys, it's Tech Nitwit here. Make sure you guys subscribe and like and hit that bell. Thanks.